All right, so Chuck, we're sitting here at PLM Connection Europe, and you presented this morning, so I wanted to touch base on a few things.
Okay.
One of the things you spent a little bit of time explaining was really this whole HD user experience and where things are headed there. Could you kind of recap for folks that weren't there what's going on?
Sure, yeah, we talked about a few things. We talked about the HD inside each of the products. So these are things like the HD 3D and NX and reporting, visual reporting and so forth in Team Center. But what I really highlighted today that I think everybody appreciated was the Active Workspace. Active Workspace is really about a search-based application, very simple to understand for everybody. I want to search for my product data. I'm going to look through all the Team Center stores, out to other enterprise data stores, and have an integrated result come back really, really fast. Active Workspace is doing that. It's got a search engine underneath it, crawls over the data, indexes it, and can provide almost instantaneous response across incredibly complicated environments. So by doing that, then we can serve up the data, visualize it very quickly, navigate within it, be able to drive reporting back, find issues, and see it all in a visual environment with something that is user experience is completely flat, kind of like what you experience on an iPad. Not a lot of screens to go into and out of. You have very simple top-level controls that let you drive into and get the right answer. It's our ambition that the user interface really does fit across all our products with the same kind of intuitive. You try it and you get an answer. You're hiding the sophistication behind these really powerful paradigms like cover flow and the ability to navigate a network and organize a network and see things with 3D visual reporting, color coding, you know, like the conditional formatting in a spreadsheet. So that's all coming to fruition now. You know, we've been talking about the fact that we would do Active Workspace, and here at this show, we're now 30 days away from really releasing that to manufacturing. So we're able to actually show all of the stuff really working together, and I think that's pretty exciting. I think everybody was really pretty pleased.
Yeah, I like the analogy. I think that made it real for people about just search capabilities and the internet, that there's so much going on behind the scenes,
sure.
But we're trying to serve it up in a much, make PLM simple.
Yeah, when you type in that search to Google, it's you're not really faced with dealing with all the complexity of what's going back in the server farms and all the analytics and intelligence going on to build up and get the proper answer. And we want that same kind of feel. We want the control to be simple and the sophistication to be behind the scenes.
Okay. Hey, one other thing you talked about today was just maybe an increased focus on academic and reaching out more to this kind of next generation of engineers. Can you just elaborate a little bit on
Sure. I think we've done a really good job of getting our technology exposed in the university system and high schools around the world. We've done lots of in-kind donations, that is software donations to each of the academic institutions expressed an interest. And we work with some of the staff and faculty in order to develop curricula. Where I think we can do even better is really driving our vision of how you might teach the next generation of engineers to use these tools. Not simply, how to turn on the CAD system and get a design done, but what it means to be part of a global team, what it means to collaborate, and things like the Active Workspace are good examples of that I think would work really well in the academic environment. To allow people who are used to Facebooking and other kinds of really rapid connections to use their paradigms that they're familiar with in their private life in the engineering environment as well. And so we're going to put a lot of energy into this area of working with faculties, working with curricula development, working with the students themselves, with the next generation of user experience. So I'm really looking forward to a lot of expansion and improvement there. I really want the engineers coming out of school who've had exposure to our technology to have it just built into them. They got to go find somebody out there that's using this cool stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And likewise, I want the companies that are using our cool stuff to be able to quickly find a brand new engineer out of school that's already familiar with it. So both sides of the equation.
Okay, good. So let's shift and talk a little bit about just any recent customer visits you've had or things going on in the customer service.
Well, clearly PLM Europe, there's lots of customers out there,
right.
So it's really great to be with each of them. And there's nice detailed sessions and opportunities to talk in the hallway. I did just come back coincidentally from Detroit, from Dearborn, where I met with our automotive customers. So they're the automotive steering group, very important part of the input mechanism to us from the really leading car companies around the world, you know, from Western Europe, India, the U.S., Japan, Korea, all come together, look at what we've done, also tell us where the issues are for them. What are they facing? Are they facing, you know, functional safety certification with ISO 26262? Are they facing new challenges of competition, integration of their suppliers? You know, what is it that's really on their minds? It might be systems engineering. And so there's a series of projects that we can then kick off around them to understand the requirements, where they believe the maximum value that PLM technology, and Siemens in particular, can deliver. And then we report back. And so from this meeting just the other day, able to get real good feedback on progress we have made, new opportunities in the future. I like those kind of things, and I think our whole team does. I mean, at the end of the day, one of the special things about our company is the ability to listen and speak in the proper proportion. And it's really, I mean, somebody once said, you know, two ears and one mouth, and yeah, they should be used in that proportion. And we really do strive to think of the world that way and to think of our customers that way. They are the experts in their operations, and, you know, we need to do the best we can to listen and use the wisdom they have and feed that back. It's kind of, you know, we're talking over the internet now. It's a poor man's version of that. We have to fly together, but there's a real high bandwidth of interaction at those meetings. So even though we can't do it all virtually, that sometimes it's necessary to get together face-to-face. When we do, we try to make the best use of it. And that was a great example.
That's good. I use the two ears, one mouth all the time in social media training. So last thing I want to touch on was, you know, continued conversations around the organizational changes that have been announced.
Sure.
We talked a little bit more at the analyst event and here.
Sure.
There's some folks now maybe higher up in the organization that mm-hmm. were more behind the scenes in the past.
Sure.
And you used to have this role of CTO before, uh-huh. and that's now been handed to Paul Sicking.
Right.
For those that don't know Paul, can you just tell us a little bit more about him and why you put him in that role?
Oh, boy. Paul Sicking is really been with the company since before I started. Actually, Paul was the first guy I worked for, and I wrote code for him in finite element modeling back in the graphics days. So he has an incredible depth of understanding of the technology. He's been really with me and with the team, providing that as you say, back room guidance, intellectual, really sort of stimulation for the entire group. What about this? What about that technologically? With the CTO's office and Paul leading that, what we've been able to do is add not only the architectural evolution that he's been directing as the sort of lead of the Office of Architecture and Technology, but we've now put together development activity. We put the open tools together with that, active workspaces being developed out of the CTO's office. And with Paul's leadership, he's one of the guys that everybody wants to work for. So he both inspires, challenges, good guy, and somebody, I hope you should have him give some of these things in the future, because I think the world wants to hear him talk.
Okay. Great. Thanks, Jeff.